Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. In this video, we will learn about pulse width modulation technique. The pulse width modulation technique is used to control the analog devices, and mainly the power which is delivered to the analog device is controlled using this technique. Now, because of its high efficiency, low power loss, and its ability to precisely control the power, this technique is used in many applications. For example, today for dimming the LED lights or for controlling the fan speed of the CPU, this PWM technique is preferred over the conventional methods. And in some laptops, even the brightness of the screen is also controlled using this pulse width modulation technique. So apart from these applications, this PWM is extensively used in the power electronic applications. So in this video, let us understand what is PWM and how it can be used to control the different analog devices. So in this pulse width modulation technique, by changing the pulse width of the control signal, the power which is delivered to the load is controlled. And let us understand what do we mean by it by taking one example. So let us say we want to control the brightness of the LED using this pulse width modulation technique. So here the electronic switch is connected between the voltage source and the LED circuit. And here this electronic switch is controlled using the external control signal. So whenever the switch is in the closed condition, then the entire voltage will appear across the LED circuit. And here let us assume that we are using the 9 volt of battery. And whenever this switch is in the open condition, then the circuit will get isolated from the voltage supply. So now if we apply a control voltage over here like this, then the switch will get turned on and off very rapidly. And if we see the waveform just after the switch, then the waveform will look like this. So if you observe this waveform here, this 9 volt of voltage is appearing across the circuit only for the half of the time. So we can say that effectively only 4.5 volt of voltage is applied to the LED circuit. Or in other words, we can say that the average value of the voltage is equal to 4.5 volt. Now instead of this 50%, if the switch remains on only for the 25% of the time, then the waveform will look like this. So in this case, if you see the average value, then the average value is reduced to the 2.25 voltage. So now effectively only this 2.25 voltage is applied to the LED circuit. So here what we are doing, by controlling the pulse width of this output waveform, we are actually controlling the voltage which is applied to the LED circuit. And in this way, we are controlling the brightness of the LED circuit. So this same technique is also used for controlling the speed of the DC motors. So whenever we talk about this pulse width modulation, then the two factors are always associated with it. One is the switching frequency and the second is the duty cycle. So if the switching frequency is 1 Hz, in that case you can see the flickering in the LED. But instead of 1 Hz, if the switching frequency is let's say 500 Hz, in that case the switch will get turned on and off very rapidly. And in that case, you feel like the LED is continuously in the on condition. So for the particular application, this switching frequency should be optimum. So depending on the application, usually the switching frequency varies from hundreds of hertz to even kilohertz. Then the next parameter for this pulse width modulation is the duty cycle. So the duty cycle defines for the what fraction of the time period the pulse remains in the on condition. Or we can say that it is the ratio of the on time to the total time period. So for some waveform, if the duty cycle is 50%, it means that the pulse remains on for the 50% of the time. Likewise, for some other waveform, if the duty cycle is 25%, it means that the pulse will remain on only for the 25% of the time. So here, the different waveforms with different duty cycles are shown. So here, by changing the duty cycle of the waveform, we are actually changing the average value of the output waveform. And by doing so, we are actually changing the average voltage which is applied to the load. So by changing this duty cycle, we can control the different devices. Now in pulse width modulation, usually a MOSFET is used as an electronic switch. And the advantage of this MOSFET switch is that during the switching, the power which is distributed across the switch is negligible. So we can say that this pulse width modulation technique is very efficient technique. And that is why nowadays it is preferred over the conventional techniques. So if you see the conventional technique for controlling the brightness of the LED, then by changing the value of this resistance R, we can change the current that is flowing through the LED. And in a way, we can control the brightness of the LED. But in this case, as the current that is flowing through the LED will increase, the power which is getting dissipated across the resistor will also increase. Apart from that, the relationship between the brightness of the LED and current is nonlinear. So in this technique, it is not possible to control the brightness linearly. On the other end, if we talk about the pulse width modulation technique, then in this technique, whenever the switch is in the closed condition, then the entire voltage is appearing across the circuit. It means that whenever the switch is in the closed condition, then the current that is flowing through the LED will remain constant. So here, just by controlling the width of this pulse, we can change the duration for which the current is flowing through the LED. So in this technique, it is possible to control the brightness linearly. So these are the few advantages of this PWM technique over the conventional methods. And that is the reason nowadays it is preferred in the many applications. So that is being said, now let us see how we can generate this PWM output signal. So the simple way of generating this PWM signal is using the comparator circuit. So here, the triangular wave is applied at the inverting node, while the control voltage is applied at the non-inverting node. So whenever this triangular wave voltage is less than the control voltage, then the output of the comparator will be low. And whenever the voltage of this triangular wave just go above this control voltage, then the output of the comparator will become high. So depending upon the value of this control voltage, the width of the pulse can be changed. So suppose if we reduce this control voltage, in that case, the width of the output pulse will increase. So in this way, by controlling this control voltage, it is possible to change the pulse width of the output waveform. So this is very simple way by which we can generate this PWM output signal. Apart from that, this signal can also be generated using the 555 timer IC. And we have already discussed this circuit whenever we have talked about the unstable mode of operation of the 555 timer IC. So here, by changing the value of this resistance R1, it is possible to change the duty cycle of the output waveform. And this circuit can be used for generating the PWM output signal. Apart from these methods, it is also possible to generate this PWM output signal using the microcontrollers. So suppose if someone uses the microcontroller board like Arduino, then it has a dedicated output pins for the PWM output signals. So using these pins, it is possible to generate the PWM output signal. And using this PWM output waveform, we can control the different devices. So I hope in this video, you understood what is pulse width modulation and using this pulse width modulation, how you can control the different devices. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.